Let's have a toast, JR. The good times. The good times. This is the J.R. Hendrick Texan Gentleman podcast that deals with the early life of my alter ego, J.R. Hendrick. This episode is in a narrated format, commentary by myself and J.R. Relax and enjoy the adventure. Take care. God bless. This is an interesting episode. This is where things begin to pick up for the good for JR once again. This episode, January 5th of 2024. The storyline is on up to from January 1st to 5th of 1996. And headline for the week, January 6th, the government shutdown of 95-96 came to an end with a budget compromise. So let's cop on over to JR Land and see what we got, shall we? Good. Here we go. This is going to make for some interesting things. I don't think there's a scene with Christine in it. But here it is, January 1st. It's thought to at least start with January 1st. It's 5 a.m. At the ranch, Mike Fields is in the front office. And Rachel is making fried chicken and dressing and mashed potatoes. The Swingfield Thanksgiving and New Year dinner. 7 a.m. Yep, Mary Jane, the mansion, Hendrick Mansion in the Baton Rouge, the Hendrick party, has a breakfast of cinnamon toast, French toast, and omelets. The last of black coffee was helping Jim, Andrew, and Claude get over their hangovers. I thought Betsy probably had, oh yeah, Mama had her share. 9 a.m. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, Mary Fields makes JR some cinnamon toast and some orange juice. It's obvious he's doing a little better. 11 a.m. on the flight back to DFW, Jim calls JR. And JR's like, "Hey, Daddy, how are you doing?" And he says, "I'm like, hey, I'm sorry. I'm sorry for the bit, you know. I spent so much of my damn time finding Kyle, appeasing him, that I forgot about my chip off the old block. And I'm going to make it up to you." And Charles was like, "Thanks, Daddy. You're my hero now." So it's obvious, you know, a year ago, JR, isn't it true that a year ago, in January 95, Daddy was a villain? Now, January 96, Daddy was a hero. That'll change at some point. Let's not give too much filler alerts. 1 p.m., 1:30 p.m. Meanwhile, back at Gainesville, Betsy and the servants are taking down the Christmas tree. Jim is in the living room reading the Bible. He's feeling penitent for not being there for his family. It's such a crucial time as Elizabeth's death, and knowing that Betsy is still at the now. No signs of it yet, but it's going to come. Trust me. It's going to come. 3 p.m. At the ranch, JR sits at his granddad Swain's rocking chair. JR is drinking ginger ale, eating crackers, only feeling slightly better. 5 p.m. As Betsy Hendrick arranges for the party in Gainesville to have a ham dinner, the Swain family is having a fried chicken dinner, and JR is eating quite a bit, although he's still under the weather. Sneezing, coughing, sinus. 7 p.m. at the ranch. JR is resting in his bed. He's still coughing like crazy. Don't you get me started. January 3rd and 4th. Okay, so we get to 2 days later. 12:10 p.m. JR is at Dr. Bertrand's office. The doctor examines JR's lungs, nose, and throat. Well, you're not worse for the wear. The stress from the Christmas holidays, that's really giving you a whacking. You have a sinus infection. I'm going to recommend some Vicodin and a shot of Vaseline. Ten minutes later, and after he left, a nurse came in to give me a shot prescription. 3 p.m. Back at the ranch, Betsy and Madison have the kids watch TV as they help the servants take down the Christmas decorations. JR is back piled up in his bed, upstairs where he belongs. 6 p.m. JR is having chicken and dumplings for dinner with the rest of the family when Sophie went out saying that he had a phone call. And so JR goes into the kitchen and he says, well, what's going on, Jim Bob? And Jim Bob, he's like, listen, JR, I invited Brad to our little dinner Friday night. I'm sorry, but it's time to put our differences aside. Oh, Jim Bob, so stupid. It's like, how could you? Jim Bob, what an idiot. Jim Bob Horton, in open mouth, insert foot. And JR listens. And JR loses it. Have you lost your damned mind? Ken and I said, no, Brad. You just stirred up a damn hornet's nest. And he hangs up the phone. Okay, so it's 9 p.m. at the Hendrick Mansion in Gainesville, and Jim is sitting there talking with the fireplace to Philip Markley. Want to thank you for talking to my son on his way back from the doctor. and offering to help him with his paper. Kim said, "You see, unlike my two other kids, JR earns his keep. I tell him that in an early age. Something that made my father-in-law very, very, very angry. I'm sorry I had to fly back to D.C. in the morning, Jim," Markley said. "But it seems like you got a ship going on with your dream team. You'll be okay." Okay, so it's 4 a.m. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, Betsy Wagon goes downstairs for a cup of coffee. And then she was going to go with Kyle to look at the inventory of deer. I should know. Surprise, surprise. That was only one time Kyle agreed to work on that ranch at that point. 8 a.m. In the kitchen, JR and Jim Bob argue over the phone. "Horton, how the hell could you do this to us?" JR said. And Jim's like, "Well, I'm sorry to have to do this, JR, but you know, I was talking about my aunt, and I'm going to back out from the meeting Friday because I feel so guilty." Jim Bob. What a loser. What a loser. First, he throws Brad into the ring. You know, not thinking about it. And then he puts in a hornet's nest. So, JR's pissed. And he screams, "Lavely, you asked me to play peacemaker? Well, no wonder Daddy has a hard time dealing with you." Okay, so Betsy walks. She runs into the kitchen. She could tell JR is like hurt, like pissed. And she's like, "JR, what the hell's going on?" As JR hangs up the phone, Jim Bob Horton, who else? Open mouth, insert foot. He's after me to go tomorrow night to be peacemaker between Ken and Brad. JR, your daddy has told me how much Jim Bob has annoyed him so bad. And the same goes for Brad. Now, Becky Crosby and I have some plans. We might take you to do some Eastern Star business. In that case, Mama, I'll go to this with this thing with Ken and Brad. But I won't go quietly. This is something that I'm not likely to forget. I'm not to forget lightly. Unless it comes to Jim Bob Horton. Him and his damn mouth. Okay. Now you see why your grandma always hated it when you got together with Ken and Brad and Jim Bob Horton. She always said that Jim Bob Horton was the worst. Okay, so it's 1 p.m. in Gainesville. Jim is being interviewed for a January 10th edition of Timmy Dreyfuss's The Case. The subject being is being bantered about was the appeal made by Bob Cooney and the ACLU before the D.C. Federal Circuit Court of Appeals. Coached by John Sestina, Jim was able to answer the reporter's questions as truthfully as he could. Okay, so it's 4 p.m. It's obvious JR is kind of well enough to get on his horse. He's out on bandits. You know, because Kyle come back to order the kids around. So JR needed a break from the house. So he put on his heavy sweater and goes to the stables to pick up Bandit. He wants a ride. JR hasn't... You hadn't ridden Bandit in a while in the episode. No, I hadn't. There's going to be a lot of riding Bandit, and particularly during the summer season. 8 p.m. Upstairs in the Hendrick Mansion in Gainesville, Jim pours himself a drink and calls Marlena Diedrich, who has just landed in Dallas, to see him after a bad fight with her husband, John. She would be staying until January the 7th, when she would fly back to Baton Rouge to reconcile with her husband. Okay, there it is, the big day. We got to make sure we get this right. So let me flip this on the side here. It'll let me. I think this is it. I'll know here in a minute. Five a.m. At the ranch, JR wakes up and goes downstairs, obviously feeling better. He takes a look at the photo of his grandmother from back in 1956. In the background, he can see his 15-year-old uncle and 13-year-old mother. 9 a.m. At the Hendrick Estate in Gainesville, Jim is on the phone with his assistant, Kelly. Hot damn, they finally made a budget, Jim said. No, I'm not saying when I'm coming back in public. And don't you tell the press nothing. I'll be back January 12th. I got lunch with President Clinton. Well, I don't want them swirling all around me the minute that I land. Sliver the end of my life. And no, unfortunately, Betsy will not be joining me. Jim hangs up the phone. I'll be damned. What's going on, Jim? Cowboy Joe said, McDonald said. I don't even want to know about it now. I say we get everybody together. We have a luncheon with Carl Rove to do some consulting. at the University of North Texas, Benton. Okay, so it's 11 a.m. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, the family is having Texas burger for lunch. And JR's still fuming. He's mad. He's mad. Can't believe Jim Bob Horton. Is that damn stupid? Enough to bow out and expect me to play peacemaker, Jared said. Junior, my offer still stands, Betsy says. Sorry, Mama, but I have to settle this. Granddad taught me that when you got back, when you get back into a corner, you settle it once and for all, like gentlemen, Gerald said. Lighten up. It's enough of the gentleman's talk. It's clear to me what an idiot you are for caving in the Jim Bob Horton, Kyle said. You know what, JR? It made me mad back then, but it's right now. Yeah. Okay, here's one scene with Christine. Mom, Jim Bob Horton is a loony, crazed dork, Christine said. Christine, we already know that, Betsy says. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree. Remember, old man Horton asked to marry me, and I said no, because your granddad said no. 1 p.m. In Denton, Jim and his dream team are meeting with Carl Rove to discuss tomorrow's rally for Phil Graham in Fort Worth. Rove was also giving him advice for just in case Phil Graham left the party primaries. 5:30 p.m. Okay, this is the big event. Okay, this is the main event that makes this whole thing. JR arrives at the Wendy's restaurant and was shocked to hear Brad and Ken talking and laughing. It's all right, Jim. It's all right, JR. Brad and I have buried the hatchet for good this time, Ken said. About what Jim Bob was up to? You didn't think I would... You didn't think I would know? Brad said. He's such a damn idiot, Jared said, laughing. And Brad says, idiot, I've been waiting for the four of us to make peace for a long time. Yeah. He acts like some crazy fool, but he did it for our own good, Brad said. Yeah, Brad. Yeah, Brad can't even understand why I smoke, Ken said. Well, I think about it. Is it Jim Bob? Took the damn ball. I thought it was going to end up badly. And now, look, it's good. I think we should all just celebrate the good times. And they all say in unison, the good times. The good times. So, with that, we're going to have a drink, JR. Sprite. Dang. Let's have a drink, JR, to the good times. Let's, JR, why don't you write this up first? Well, I'm going to give it a 4.5 lemon-lime sodas, a phone call from Daddy, and the good times. 4.5 lemon-lime sodas, a Jim Bob Horton piece, and the good times. Hope you enjoyed listening to the J.R. Hendrick Texan Gentleman. If you like what you hear, please subscribe, become a part of the adventure. This is the James Hendrick Empowerment Network saying until next time, get ready for the rest of the story. It's going to get more interesting from here. Get ready for the father-son bond, part 2. God bless you. Have a blessed week.